Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for joining us. My name is Ron Brownstein. I'm the editorial director of Atlantic Media, co-sponsors of the Aspen Ideas Festival, and I am here with Tom Steyer, the founder and formerly the co-senior partner of Farrell and Capital Management, with the co-founder of Next Generation, which is a nonprofit institution that works on issues relating to energy and climate and also on issues affecting children, a member of the Board of Trustees of Stanford University, but perhaps best known to many of you here as an environmental activist who spent large sums of his own money in 2014 to support candidates committed to action on global climate change. We're here to talk broadly about the state of the climate debate in the nation and the world, what it might mean for the 2016 election, and the issue on the marquee here, which is California's unique role in this debate over the last several decades. But I want to start, Tom, by asking you your view on the big picture. If you think across the board, looking at both the domestic debate and the international debate, at actions in the public sector and the private sector, compared to when you first started working on this issue, are you more or less optimistic about our ability to avoid the worst consequences of climate change?
So obviously, it's a definitional question, what are the worst consequences of climate change? Mm-hmm. But what I would say is this, I am much more optimistic than 5 years ago. And the reason I'm much more optimistic is I try to stay in touch with the technology and have an idea of what people are doing in the private sector. And what, you know, what I see in the private sector is, you know, very encouraging, the kind of research and advancement and entrepreneurship that I associate with California and the rest of the United mm-hmm. States. Mm-hmm. And I think that's going to be, it's incredibly exciting and encouraging to see what American business can do when it gets the bit in its teeth.
And does that need public sector action to cause it to reach critical mass? Or is the economic case for new forms of energy, greater efficiency, is that sufficient by itself to impel the level of change?
So I think if you look right now at where it, you know, what it costs to build new power plants and create kilowatt hours, you know, I think over half of what was built last year in the United States was solar. And what, that's obviously affected by government policies. But when you look at the cost curves of where we are for renewables and where we are for fossil fuels, you know, we're on a decline curve for renewables. Mm-hmm. And the question is, how fast is that, you know, there's the equivalent, not nearly as powerful as Moore's Law, but there's an equivalent law in terms of as the installed base grows, the costs go down. And it's been in place for decades and it's pretty robust. And so you can sit there and see, you know, pretty much if we build this much solar, what are the costs going to do? And, you know, the point about public policy is as they change the effective prices for consumers or for utilities, then they make the installed base grow faster and the cost curve come down faster and they make the lines cross sooner.
Yeah.
So would it happen inevitably? If I think it would, but the fact of the matter is what policy does is make that cost curve move more quickly.
You know, and we're here to talk about California, which has engaged really in that effort going back decades. Things are a little better now, but for most of the past probably 20 years, people have been not so much inclined to look at California as a model for how to you know, structure public policy, but more budget deficits and legislative gridlock and kind of proliferation of ballot initiatives, a state that didn't seem to work very well. But on energy and the environment, there is a different story. What do you think the California experience
says.
On dealing with says?
So I'm going to get to energy, but first I'm going to rebut the original statement about California.
Yeah.
So I would say this. I mean, I'm very proud of California. I love California. And
I live in California.
And I like to say that Californians lead, which is we had the most dysfunctional legislature before the United States had the most dysfunctional mm-hmm. legislature. Mm-hmm. We couldn't pay our bills before the United States couldn't pay our bills. We couldn't, you know, I'm waiting for the United States to start paying their workers with scrip so I can say we also led in that.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact of the matter is we've come out the other side.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at where we are, we're running budget surpluses.
Right.
We're putting money away in a rainy day fund, so we're not even spending what we're taking in. And the state of California is going back to being what it was. We were in a crisis that was a governmental political crisis because we had extreme partisanship before the rest of the United States had extreme partisanship, and it basically froze us. And so people watched that and thought, wow, that is really dysfunctional, and they were right. But the other thing I'd say is, and I'm gonna get to the energy part, but the other thing that's true about California was, so that was the 90s and from 2000 to 2010. In that time, look at the incredible companies that California produced. Look at the amazing job the private sector in California did, the companies it produced, the value it produced, the jobs it produced. It's really a very, very powerful and positive story. So when I'll now connect this to energy. I mean, in energy, from a policy standpoint, we've been very progressive for, you know, at least going back to 1970, and I would argue for, since before 1970. And part of the reason was we had big problems. You know, LA air quality is famously bad, and there were reasons that we were putting in smog controls before anyone else. There were reasons that we were putting in policies. But the fact of the matter is we put in very progressive policies, and they've been adopted around the United States to a very large extent. Yeah.
You know, you go back to the 70s, the first appliance efficiency standards in the country were imposed in California by Jerry Brown as an alternative to building a nuclear power plant in San Diego. Decoupling of electricity, first utility reform of that sort, kind of fast forward, stringent, strong, renewable energy requirements in the early 2000s, first greenhouse gas bill at the state level. What has been the political dynamic that has allowed all of these steps, many of which, I mean, pretty much all of which were controversial at the time, what has been the political dynamic that's allowed them to move forward in California before they were able to take root in other places?
Well, one thing I do honestly think, and you see it, the equivalent in China now, is when you can see the actual health impacts and life impacts for citizens, they're going to be behind you. That's one thing I think was very true in California. And I think if you go back to 1970 and the time of Earth Day, people could really physically see pollution, and they could see the Cuyahoga River burning, and they thought, you know, we need to do something about this. I think in addition, in California, we have a unusual confidence in technology, in American business, and the idea that ingenuity, research, science is going to answer a lot of questions, and we're willing to commit to that when the answers aren't totally clear. So if you think about us having, we have a 33% renewable portfolio standard by 2020.
Right.
And when that went into effect, I don't think that it was clear how that was going to happen, and people were worried about it. I think that Californians are willing to say, we do great research, we're going to come up, you know, basically, if you build it, they will come. If you impose the deadline, then companies are going to respond, and companies are going to see markets. They're going to know that if they produce it, that they're going to have a customer.
Right.
And therefore, you're going to see the cost curves come down, and you're going to see real innovation. And, you know, we believe that, you know, good engineers and scientists come up with great answers that no one had thought of before they went into their garage together and figured it out. And we actually think that, and it turns out to be true.
So if you look at, you know, some of the areas that in the past, as we said, the California has been kind of at the forward edge and has influenced other states, they would include the appliance efficiency standards, they would include renewable energy portfolio standards, they would include the greenhouse gas emissions. Looking forward, where else do you think actions now underway or contemplated in California may also ripple into other states and national policy?
So, for the non-Californians in the room, there are three specific proposals in front of the legislature right now, which have passed the state Senate, but are still have to pass the equivalent of the House. And they are 50-50-50. 50% renewable portfolio standard by 2030, 50% improvement in building efficiency by 2030, 50% reduction in the amount of gasoline used by the state by 2030. So that is been proposed by the president pro tem of the Senate, supported by the governor, and that's kind of where we are. So when I think about where California is, I think about two things. I think about the policy, and you know what, how much of those policies are a step beyond policies that are already on the books. How much of a bet do we have that we're going to come up with new stuff and cool new ideas? And how much are already there in effect because of laws or regulations on the books in the state or at the federal level?
What would you say would be the biggest hurdles to overcome? Assuming the legislature passes the 50% renewable requirement by 50% of the state's electricity by 2030 to come from renewable sources, what would be the biggest hurdles to overcome to get there? I think it's about 15% now or so, I think
that's no. What is it? The current thing on the books is 33%.
No, I'm saying the actual currently. The 33% is the goal by 2020, 50% by 2030, but I think the state is about at 15%.
No, I think it's higher than that.
You think it's higher?
Yes, we're gonna get to 33% before 2020. So it's at 15%, okay. We'd be in a lot of trouble.
Okay, so what is gonna be the biggest hurdles to getting to 50% by 2030?
So the 50% RPS standard, let me start by saying there are three big investor-owned utilities in the state of California, none of whom are opposing this.
Mm-hmm.
They're not necessarily supporting it, but what they want to say is give us flexibility in how we get there, and we can do this. When I think about this from my standpoint and what is going to be the hard part, to me this is going to be a big engineering question about the grid. Is going to be, I actually think by 2030, is renewable energy going to be really, really cheap? Yeah. I think it's going to be really, really cheap. I don't think it's going to be a question of cost. I think it's going to be a question of flexibility in the grid, storage, interactivity, time management, you know, demand management, a lot of tough, granular, technical engineering questions. I think that's where the functionality is going to have to, a lot of time and, you know, good work is going to have to go into. And I think that it's kind of in the structure that it's going
to
happen.
Because those factors that you allude to, people talk about the question of intermittency, the intermittency of these sources, and when you get up to very high levels of reliance on them, does that become an issue? When wind blows, when the sun isn't out?
I think that people want to turn on their lights even when the sun is down, yeah, and the wind's not blowing,
right. So,
unless I'm wrong.
Yeah.
I have a feeling that it's necessary for that to happen with 100% consistency.
As California moves forward, you know, some people say it has intrinsic advantages that other states don't have in trying to move in this direction on both efficiency and renewables. As a temperate climate, 2/5 of the state homes either don't have an air conditioner or don't use one, according to the State Power Commission. It has less heavy industry than many other states. How much of what California has done and achieved can be explained by local advantages not easily replicated elsewhere?
Well, I've read, I don't know if you guys know, but Ron actually wrote an article on this. So were I to go against his research, he would skewer me in public. So I'm going to try not to do that. I would say
this. Is it easier for California, basically?
Your point is that we have advantages, natural advantages, because of the temperate climate. I would say it's also very substantially important to us that we don't do a lot of heavy manufacturing. So when you look around the country, there are places that do a lot of heavy manufacturing, so they not only generate electricity differently from us, they use it differently from us. Mm-hmm. And so California's model is not going to be perfect for the rest of the country for a whole bunch of reasons. People in Ohio are going to be smarter about energy in Ohio than people in California. That is true. It's also true that there is a measurable positive impact of having progressive energy policies in terms of moving down the cost curve. But the biggest thing that I think is this. When you think about where we are from an industry standpoint, you know, you're looking at technology-based energy. And every technology business, I mean, if you think about it in terms of computing power, where it's really the most obvious, this tent would not have been able to do the computing power that my Apple phone can do when I started in business. So the ability for technology to consistently compound benefits and move down both functionality and cost, it's inexorable. That is a pin to the human spirit and the ingenuity of Americans. That is something which, if it happens in California and we get the cost down, it's absolutely transferable. Because once you have the technology and the right way, then, you know, there's no reason that can't be used in Florida or
It doesn't
Texas.
Stop at the border.
Right.
Yeah. So let me ask you just a couple final questions about California, then turn to both the national and the international debate. One other, you know, if the climate may be California's great advantage in this, I think maybe its greatest disadvantage is its reliance on the car. and just how dependent so many metro areas in the state are on people driving themselves to and from work and to and from everywhere they're going. Can that be solved just by technology, or do, in terms of like, you know, more fuel efficient cars, removing more carbon from gasoline, or do we have to rethink kind of the way we basically organize our zoning and the way we live and our reliance on the car versus mass transit? Can you solve the transportation side just from technology?
Well, it depends what you mean when you say solve the transportation side. Because I think there are two things going on. One has to do with the fact that people are spending a god-awful amount of their time sitting in traffic.
Yeah.
Now, that has to do with people's lives and how much fun they're having, and what, you know, how they get to spend their day. And I think statistically, believe it or not, taking a long, painful commute makes you unhappy.
Mm-hmm. That's pretty shocking.
It's not a minor point. If you know people who have to go an hour and 15 minutes or an hour and a half each way in traffic, it's very hard on you. So that is actually a transportation problem that particularly affects working people who don't necessarily can't afford to live near their jobs and therefore are spending a lot of time on the road. So obviously that is something where public transportation, no one ever complains about a subway that's been built. A lot of people complain along the way, but obviously having public transportation makes people's lives really better. What I would say in terms of can technology solve the emissions issues about cars? Yeah. I mean, that's a different question. And you know, the thing that I would urge on everybody is do not think that people won't come up with new ideas. You know, when people talk about the driverless car, they talk about all the different kinds of cars, they also have big knock-on effects in terms of energy usage and emissions. So the way that this is going to get solved, you know, do not underestimate the creativity of business people to come up with ideas that no one else has come up with that have big positive impacts that we aren't thinking of because we're not spending all our time thinking about it.
So the final question on California before we turn to the nation and kind of flows out of that. There are critics, and maybe most prominently the urban writer Joel Kotkin, who says that the green agenda in California is squeezing middle class families, both in raising their cost of living, but also in making it tougher for businesses to create kind of those middle class jobs either in manufacturing or energy extraction, and that ultimately this is what he would call the urban, the liberal gentry agenda that is pushing middle class people out of the state.
Okay, so obviously I think that is, I reject that totally. Yeah. I don't know which ways you want me to come at that, but I'll start with this.
All sides.
The fact of the matter is we're gonna end up with cheaper energy through this. Mm-hmm. That's the first point. Second of all, if you think about those three rules, who is against more energy efficient buildings? Well, making buildings more energy efficient, a lot of that's going to be technology, a lot of that's going to be software, but a lot of that's going to be people, electricians, going about their work.
You know, and to go back for one more point about California, we were talking about before about the role of kind of the natural advantages versus the role of public policy. The natural advantages have always been there. And in 1970, per capita electricity use in California was 4% below the national average. Now it's 24%. Below the national average.
I thought it was more than that too, Ron, just so you know.
Yeah, so it's, I'm sure of those numbers. So some of that may reflect migration of industry out of the state, but by and large, it would argue there is a policy impact.
The mission statement of what we're doing is to prevent climate disaster and promote prosperity for all Americans. If we do not believe that it is possible or positive for us to do things that are going to be bad for the citizens of the United States in terms of jobs, income, and work. So if we are not, when you describe me as an environmentalist, I was sitting there thinking, actually, I think of myself much more as a business person who is trying to use the private sector to solve a problem that is facing all of us. So when I think about California and I think about what this is going to mean for us, let me tell you a short story, which I took a big lesson from, but maybe I'm wrong. So I was talking to a bunch of what I thought were moderate to conservative business people, and they were asking me if China was sincere in their climate goals. Were they sincere or were they just messing with us and, you know, being dragged along? And I said, no, you know, I think these guys are really sincere. They've got terrible air pollution problems. On the back end, they've got terrible water problems. They really don't have a choice in terms of their relationship with the citizens of China without doing something about this in the short term or in the, and in the medium and long term as well. So I believe them to be very sincere. And this one gentleman who was from Texas said, you know, I think you're being naive. I think these guys think they can dominate one of the biggest industries in the world. That they can come up with technologies, if they can get down the curve, that they basically, instead of being going around the world, which we all know they do, basically seeking energy to power their businesses, they can not only power their businesses, but they can export the technology and have a great business, you know, a gigantic global advantage. Which made me think, I listened to that and I thought, okay, I'm sure there's something to that, that's probably a good point. But I also thought, okay, if that's true, why isn't that true for us? If we're going to do the technology work, if we're going to come down the cost curve, if we're going to have the engineers and scientists figuring this out, then we'll bloody well get that advantage. And why shouldn't we? And we're, you know, it's absolutely in our interest to build these businesses, build these industries, and have American energy not only serving us, but being able to export it around the world too, because that's going to have to happen. One way or the other, energy is going to go to a lot of people in the world who don't use a lot of energy now.
Let me ask you about the role of public policy at the national level. This summer, the EPA is scheduled to finalize really a cornerstone of the president's agenda on these issues, which is its rule governing carbon emissions from existing power plants. The rule was structured in an unusual way, giving states a lot of flexibility. Rather than prescribing plant by plant, setting goals for states instead and giving them a lot of freedom to try to meet that goal. What is your view of the regulation, the EPA rule?
Yeah. Look, I'm supportive of what the president's doing, very supportive. I think what he was trying to do in the way that you describe it was to basically say to everybody, we're not asking you to get to the same place. We're actually asking you to move from where you are. Mm-hmm. So you're not, I mean, I think one big thing about energy, it is very local. If you look at the state of Washington, they get a lot of hydro. Well, it turns out New Mexico probably can't get the same amount of hydro that Washington get. So you're asking them to do it the way that the state of Washington does isn't fair, sensible, or intelligent. So what he was, I think it was partially political and partially substantive in the sense that politically asking people who hadn't gone very far along to suddenly do in 10 years what had taken 40 years for another state to do didn't seem reasonable, didn't seem possible. So what they were trying, and I think that's the political side of it, and also the substantive side, to try and make it fair so we could all move together to a place. You know, I know that obviously this is a rule that is, you know, controversial in some parts of the United States.
Yeah.
But I think that from my standpoint, we're going to end up, I mean, you were asking the question about costs. I think we're going to bring costs down for Americans. And when that happens, then this debate is going to go away.
You know, you're kind of alluding to one aspect of the rule that is, that has generated a lot of commentary, particularly among environmentalists. I mean, there are environmentalists who feel that the rule is kind of unfair in that it seems to be, in some cases, asking more of the states with lower emissions than some of the states that are at the higher end, the North Dakotas and Kentuckys and Indianas. You seem to be saying that that's a is that a political judgment worth making? You know, or does it go too far?
Ron, here's what I'd say. You know, I'm sure a lot of people in this room have done political or business deals. And every time I've ever done a political deal or a business deal, they're all business, really. When I go back out of the room and explain to the people who I'm working with what I've done, they've always said, that's what you could do?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Could we get 10% more? I mean, that seems like a gimme.
Uh-huh.
You're like, no, that's what we can do. And I feel like, look, they spend a lot of time. I'm sure everyone in this room could sharpshoot how the rule could be better, and probably everyone would be right. But the fact of the matter is, they tried to do something that was fair, they tried to do something that was equitable, and I think that sharpshooting it at this point is not productive.
Is regulation the best way to handle this, or do you think we would be better off with a legislative solution?
Look, I think everybody thinks that the best way to do this is to get really effective cost accounting, so that once all the costs are included, and then you just let business and consumers make every decision based on self-interest.
Cost accounting would mean putting a price on carbon emissions.
It means basically putting what is a level playing field. You know, I think what we're doing now is kind of the inverse of a price on carbon. We're trying to subsidize industries that are clean, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, they're doing, you know, tax relief for wind and solar. And the issue with that is, there's still an issue with that. I mean, it sounds like it makes sense, but that actually involves much more government control and decision-making than actually works the best. Because if you think about it, they're saying, we're gonna support this industry this much. We're gonna support this industry this much. So it's kind of a siloed attempt to work down these different cost curves. Whereas in fact, and I know that God is in the details in this, that getting good cost accounting is easy to say, but very, very difficult to do. But the fact of the matter is, if you have something where you do something that cuts across industries, then you just compete. And it's like, you don't support, the government doesn't decide to support this industry. This industry either works or it doesn't work, and that's how it should be.
And in your view?
So you want a horizontal way of thinking about this as opposed to a vertical siloed way.
And in your view, what would be the best way to get to that cost accounting? A carbon tax, a cap and trade system like the Senate, the House passed in 2009? What's the best way to achieve
well,
that?
I have a different way of thinking about this, Ron, because from my point of view, the first thing that I wanted was just to have people say, at a minimum, what George Schultz says, which is, we don't have to get to 100% to know that this is a big problem if it's true, and therefore we can do what Ronald Reagan did and take out an insurance policy and decide to deal with it. So that's the first step. Mm-hmm. The second step is to say, if we get there and we're just arguing about the different ways to enact policy, to me that's, honestly, I consider that to be a home run because I have opinions about these different things, but the fact of the matter is, if you think about the president's clean power plan, everybody's gonna have a different opinion, everyone's gonna have a different interest. We're gonna all sit in a room and scream and yell, that's the American way. That doesn't bother me. The fact of the matter is, getting cost accounting perfect is impossible. And so doing the best job we can, whether it's a cap and trade is what we've traditionally used as Americans, to be honest.
Yeah.
Because what we've really said is, there's one thing we wanna control and everything else the market's gotta control. Yeah. That's the most, I think, market-oriented solution. But if someone said to me that there's a better solution that are gonna let businesses compete more heads up, more on an even playing field, I'm sitting here waiting to be convinced and I'm happy to listen to it. And I know that, I think one of the interesting things that's happening on this is happening real time, which is, I don't know if you guys read the Wall Street Journal, but for those of you who are journal readers.
I'm guessing there are a few.
Yeah. There are probably a couple.
In the room, yeah.
There was an editorial last week on the carbon tax and basically saying the thing that scares us about a carbon tax is this just a way to build up the government. This is a whole bunch of money, a new revenue source for the government. You know, this is, and that is really scary because what we're really concerned about is size of government, scope of government, trying to control the economy, too many fingers and too many pies. There were two things that I thought were significant about that. One is, obviously, a lot of people have been saying from the beginning this should be revenue neutral. Every dollar that comes in should make sure that there's an exact equal dollar that doesn't come in so that it's substitute either, and there are a bunch of different ways to do that whether, that people like. But I think the other thing that was true is the journal wasn't saying the idea of taxing carbon is insane, which is what they've been saying for the last 10 years. They said that bringing extra money into the government is an incredible intrusion onto the liberties of Americans. They weren't saying that by definition we reject the whole idea, which I thought was a change.
And I would just point it out as an historical footnote. In the book that Mitt Romney released early in his presidential campaign, No Apologies, he writes favorably of the idea of a carbon tax swap with a lowering of the payroll tax, which is obviously not something he kind of returned to as the campaign went on. Let me ask you, the question that is always, that has confounded me about the possibility of a legislated solution is this issue of the overlap of ideology and interest, and the kind of the pattern in which the red states that are generally the most skeptical of government involvement to begin with are also the ones most heavily invested in the traditional fossil fuel economy. If you look at the states that voted for Mitt Romney in 2012, 4/5 of them have higher per capita carbon emissions in the country. If you look at the states that voted for Obama in 2012, 4/5 of them have lower per capita carbon emissions than the country. And when you kind of look at, you kind of see kind of a reinforcing effect here of ideology and interest. You've been working with former Treasury Secretary Hank Paulson, with former New York City Mayor Mike Bloomberg, and going to some red states. Is there a dialogue that you can have in places that are both skeptical of government and also heavily reliant on coal or other fossil fuels to make a case why this is not a form of economic suicide or an imposition from blue states on them?
Well, obviously, this is a key question. And I think let's start by everybody in the room admitting that we have all been big users of fossil fuels for our entire lives and continue to be. So the idea of, you know, I mean, I think the biggest part of this is the partisanship and getting away from that. Everybody in this room uses fossil fuels a lot. Everybody in this room and their kids are subject to what happens in the natural environment over time, and it's really important to all of us. So from my point of view, that's why I think I am not sitting here complaining about the Clean Power Plan being too easy on red states. From my point of view, I have always felt this was going to be a national effort and it was going to be a bipartisan effort. And so if we can't go, that's why our mission statement says, and promote prosperity for all Americans. If we can't with conviction and honesty go and say this is going to be good for the people of your state, then I can't expect anybody to welcome us.
When you go to Oklahoma, or on the one hand, an energy producing state, or Ohio on the other, which is heavily dependent on coal for its electricity, Kentucky, what can you say in those states? How can you make the case that your mission statement is true for them?
Well, I think in Ohio, those guys were doing a great job. They put it on hold. But the fact of the matter is, Ohio is a place that has great manufacturing capability. Mm-hmm. So the question on this is going to be, I mean, all you're really talking to me about is a commodity. And it's a commodity where we can look and see the cost coming
down. The electricity is a commodity.
Yeah. Well, that's what you're talking about, manufacturing in Ohio.
Right.
So we can sit there and say, this is going to be something. No one thinks that we're going to 100% renewables tomorrow. It's infeasible. It can't happen. This is something that's going to take us decades. The question is, how hard are we going to work at it? And how much of a project do we think it is for the United States of America? I think this is a huge project for the United States of America, which we will succeed at, which we will lead the world at, which we will make a ton of money at, and which we will feel very good about, and we will do together. So I look at Ohio and I say, those people have real skills. They should be in this game. They should be bringing those skills to bear, and we're going to do a lot better together than apart.
You know, the president last year in an interview with the New York Times, speaking not only about domestically, but globally, said of the oil and gas reserves in the ground, we're not going to be able to burn it all, flatly. We're not going to be able to burn it all. Is he right?
What the president is saying is that when you do the math of the proved reserves and what the emissions are, what that would mean from the standpoint of CO2 and the relationship of CO2 to temperature. The fact of the matter is, we don't, and those are, incontrovertible, that basically some over 60% of it, if we do it, we move into a place the president want to move. The issue is going to be, again, I would say technology and innovation. Because the fact of the matter is, right now, those emissions just go up in the air. It's also true, and this is a single example, and it is maybe the exception that proves the rule. There are coal plants that you can build next to enhanced oil recovery, where you sell the CO2 to the people so they can get more oil out of the ground. So it actually makes sense to burn coal and doesn't create, you know, carbon pollution. So the fact of the matter is, you're saying to people that we won't come up with a way to capture and use carbon in a sensible way, or we won't be able to do it cheap enough to compete with other forms of energy.
And you're open to the possibility that the answer may be that we can't.
Look, in the United States, we don't talk a lot about carbon capture and sequestration. In Europe, they talk about it all the time and think that this is the thing that's the technology that's going to lead. I mean, one of the things that is really true in this, which I'm sure a bunch of you do see, and maybe because I live in California and people think I have a low IQ, I see more than most, but I get people coming to me with like the perfect energy cure 3 times a week. I mean, I'm just going to tell you, I had one guy tell me this week he can create wind energy at 2 cents a kilowatt hour, 3D printing of cars, which is going to save like over 50% of the emissions from the time they're manufactured to the time they're put in the scrap heap, tankless water heater that saves like 60% of the water, 50% of the energy. The sensors, you know, basically the stuff you read in the New Yorker, and different prices for storage that are dramatic. People are, some of those people are crackpots. Some of those people are not crackpots. People are smart. They're going to be sitting there coming up with new stuff. You know, when Henry Ford came up with the V8 engine in his kitchen, no one had sat there and said, you know, well, the reason that we're gonna have more powerful engines is someone's gonna come up with the V8. No, he came up with the V8.
Oh, so, all right, let me ask you about the public, let me ask you to go back on the kind of the public sector side. You made a big personal intervention in 2014 to try to change the political dynamic, supporting candidates committed to action on this issue. There are estimates you spent about $70 million of your own money, which would even get you your own tent, I think, here at Aspen. But
now that's exciting.
It was a tough year for Democrats, and many of the candidates you supported lost. What lessons did you take from that experience in 2014 about electoral politics?
Well, from my point of view, politics in the United States, for better or worse, has stopped being about convincing people of ideas and is much more about convincing people to show up. So when I think about 2014, actually the part that I enjoyed the most was the idea of getting people involved and people talking about it and caring about it. I'm a huge believer in American democracy and that Americans are smart and that we come up with great answers. 2014 was the lowest participation in American election since 1942, and I think 1942 was skewed by the fact there are so many people overseas.
Yeah.
So when I think about the disappointment in 2014, the question is either political party speaking to people about the things they care about the most? And are they enough for them to show up at the polls? And that is a real fundamental issue for our democracy, because if you look particularly at people under the age of 35, they just didn't show up.
Yeah.
And from my point of view, participation is actually the thing that I believe in the most.
So what role are you planning in 2016?
Look, what we really focused on in 14 and what we'll focus on in 16 is voter-to-voter contact. What we really believe in is people, citizens from the locales talking to each other. That is by far the thing that we believe in for the short term, the medium term, and the long term. We really want Americans to be involved because we think it really matters. And we think that, you know, we believe some stuff, but the fact of the matter is we're much more interested in people participating and being involved because we think that is actually going to be the answer. You know, it's the earliest kind of crowdsourcing.
So will you have a campaign of comparable magnitude in 2016? Will you do as much? Will you do more than what you did in 2014?
I think it'll be different because I think 2016 is a presidential year.
Yeah.
And so I think that
How will that change what you do?
I think the dynamics will be totally different. I don't know how many of you guys, I know at least some of you guys have bought TV time, you know, around an election. I think the more you look at it, the more you see people crowding. The average, I think the delay, a TV ad sticks with the average voter, I think, for 7 days. So I think a lot of people know that fact. That is not a brand new fact. So that what people are doing more and more is spending their money as closely as they can to the election. There are only a certain number of hours. Voters are not idiots. They can turn off the TV too. They know the technology lets you skip the ads. The real question is, how are you going to engage people in an authentic way so that they're willing to go to the polls? And you know, that's what we're going to think about, and that's the issue.
And do you expect you'll be involved at both the presidential and the congressional level in 2016? You'll be involved on both sides?
I have no, we don't have specific plans. I mean, I think the other thing that's really going on is I think it's much more fluid than people think. Stuff is going to happen. There are like 17 Republicans running.
Right.
You know, if you think back to every election, events occur that throw off everybody's expectations. You know, the front runner doesn't always win. They say stupid things, things happen, people get sick, somebody catches fire, the world changes.
Give me, We're going to bring in the audience in a couple minutes. But let's real quick. You mentioned there are actually 16. We're heading toward the sequel. 18 is enough. But there are 16 Republican candidates. Is there any one of them that you have heard who you think is broadly in line with your view of the problem on climate change and is committed to acting on it? Any of those candidates?
I don't know, because I don't think that they've really come out with detailed policies. I think the fact of the matter is, if you look, everybody in politics is trying to figure out how to speak about this issue, including Republicans. And I think that there's movement, and I think that everybody is trying to be responsible. If you break it down into dealing with the results of extreme weather events and trying to avoid extreme weather events or avoid climate change, Republican office holders are fully aware that they need to protect their citizens and want to do things that will, you know, ensure that they can go about their business safely and happily. So that part, I think, is, you know, that's going to happen for anybody who takes seriously their job, which they do. The question is, what are we going to do on a broader scale from a policy standpoint so that going forward we're dealing with the underlying issues in a way that will promote prosperity for all Americans? And I think that people are really wrestling with that, and I think that Republicans are wrestling with that, and I think there's movement. And I started by saying I think everybody in this room has been a big user of fossil fuels, and I think that really what has to happen is they've got to figure out more and more how can we do this in a responsible way that'll be good for my constituents. And so I'm very hopeful that they will continue to move and come up with what I would think are common sense policies that will make us, you know, will not split the idea. I really reject the idea that we're either going to have a healthy economy or a sound environment. Actually, what we're going to do is we're going to have both.
I want to ask you a couple final things and then bring in the audience for questions. I think there'll be microphones. How do you assess Hillary Clinton on these issues? One issue of big concern to you, the Keystone Pipeline, she has been noticeably silent on.
First of all, I would put Hillary in the category of people who haven't come out with detailed policies. So I think it's unfair to judge exactly what she's going to say, because I think you got to give her a chance to say it. Uh-huh. And I think for everybody, there's new information all the time. I think she said this is an issue that she takes really seriously and that she will, you know, put in the forefront of what she does. My strong guess is that she will want to embed it in an economic policy, an economic growth policy for middle-class Americans.
Yep.
And that she will want to say, look, what I'm really for is strong growth and good job prospects and healthy wages for middle-class and working-class Americans, and this is the way you get it, and that will be part of what she does. But I don't know, and I think it's only fair to let all of these people think it through and come out with what their best ideas.
And it is worth noting that one thing she has done is defended the EPA climate regulations. So she has been on the record on supporting that. Let me ask you one last thing, going back to the politics side, and then we'll bring everybody in. You spent a lot of your own money in 2014. We've seen enormous spending on both sides of this issue, on both sides of every issue. I mean, we're kind of in a remarkable situation here with sitting here right here in this tent, where we see people who are sometimes seen as the opposite poles of this spending. Do you feel like post Citizens United, you're in some kind of arms race here between left and right, Republican and Democrat? Does this work, having both sides spending all this money? Does it get you more engagement?
Well, first of all, if we're in an arms race, we're in a lot of trouble.
Okay.
So no, I don't see it that way. I see this as a question of who has the best ideas. And can you explain those in a way that is meaningful to citizens? And I think that I don't see this as, you know, I honestly have always felt this was going to be our generational challenge and that Americans were going to push on this together. So I have never felt that this was something where we weren't going to come together. I think people have different interests, and I think that that's normal. And I think people have different ideologies, and I think that's normal. But I view this as a question of, can we recognize the problem? And then the interests and the ideologies are fine, because we realize we just there's something that we have to do together, and then no one's going to get their way entirely.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the American way.
All right, let's bring in the audience for a couple questions. So we have a microphone. How about right here in the green shirt? There.
Frank Mahler, Melbourne, Australia. Could you please tell me what the solar thermal plants in California are doing and whether the storage in molten salt is working?
Solar thermal, he was asking. How are the solar thermal plants in California
so performing? Unfortunately, the person you should be asking is my 27-year-old son, who is an engineer and could give you all the details. If I would be just good enough to be dangerous. What I will say is this: I do look at storage a lot, but I look at it on a pretty gross basis, which is to say, I try and look and see where are we per kilowatt hour, so I can understand when you look across when you put storage together with distributed energy, at what point are we going to get to a place where people say, okay, that's a good deal for me. And not because I'm a nice guy and not because I'm an environmentalist or anything else, this is just a good deal for me. Because that is when, and so storage is really important because of the intermittency issue. Now there are a lot of other things that you can use to mitigate intermittency, but that's why we can't, but storage is a critical element in a lot of ways to where we're going, not just for the grid, not just for electricity generation, but for transportation, of course. So where we're going in terms of battery efficiency and costs, I mean, we all know that at some point that becomes, you know, a dynamic thing.
See,
and I do watch it, but if I gave you the answer, someone would tell me I was wrong, and they'd be right.
There we go, sir.
Thank you, Stan Kritzik. All the presidential candidates, announced and unannounced, are promoters of corn ethanol, largely because corn has grown very heavily in my neighboring state, Iowa. There's a lot of engineering science that says that if you look at the life cycle of fertilizer, this, that, the other thing, by the time you're done, it's a loser, both from the standpoint of energy and carbon. I wonder if you've looked at the science and where you stand on it.
So I would say I have looked at the science. In the words of many people running for office, I have to say I'm not a scientist. But I've talked with the corn growers in Iowa, and I've talked with some of the people who run big ethanol plants. And I'll tell you what I do know, and I'll tell you what I don't know. What I do know is they've, like all technology-based businesses, they've gotten a lot better since the ethanol plant, since ethanol first started to be used in terms of transportation to be mandated to be used as part of our fuel supplies. They use numbers where they claim very big advantages, and I've then talked to people who think at this point it's basically a push. I don't know a lot of people. I knew a lot of people 5 years ago who thought it was from soup to nuts, it was much worse than nothing. I'd say at this point a lot of people who don't really like corn ethanol don't like it because they think that basically it doesn't help. I don't know a lot of people who think that they haven't managed to make this efficient enough where it's at least a break even, and they would argue for a very big advantage. I think when you look at the numbers, and I'm dumb enough to have tried, what it really comes down to is trying to figure out what the land would be used for otherwise and put that into the calculation. So when I think about this, this is a perfect example. When you're using a vertical idea where we're now mandating corn ethanol or subsidizing corn ethanol, then you're going to get an answer, and it may not be the right answer. If you're doing something that is a level playing field across industries, then ethanol is just a fuel with a cost and, you know, an amount of punch for your car, and you figure out whether you want to use it. And so when I think about corn ethanol, that's honestly the way I think about it, which is there are people arguing really hard on both sides of this. Obviously, Iowa is a very important political state, and there are a lot of jobs in corn in Iowa, and therefore people are going to care about that. But the fact of the matter is, I think it's changed over the last 5 or 10 years. It's better than people think. Whether it's as good as the corn growers say, I mean, they're obviously going to give you the argument from its best
Let's
point.
Let's go. There's a woman over there. Thank you.
Hi, I wanted to ask about the business leadership or missing business leadership on getting a price on carbon. You know, they've always been, historically, businesses help lead on these big infrastructure questions. you have done a great job with this risky business thing. What have you learned yourself about trying to recruit national business leaders?
So first of all, I think American business people have a deep allegiance to their companies and their shareholders. And so they view that as their overriding, you know, duty. And I think also they are very fact-based and try to be honest in terms of the way they approach the world. And I think that American businesses actually are moving on this faster than people understand, both in terms of seeing the market opportunity and in terms of understanding that society is going to have to deal with this. So I actually, you know, my thesis, when I say half of our mission statement is promote prosperity for all Americans, we really think that if this isn't going to be good for American business, it's not going to happen. We don't do huge economic changes in the United States with business steadfastly opposing. It doesn't make any sense. I mean, basically, they have to be both a ratifier that it's possible and reasonable, and in effect, there have to be people who grow up who think, wow, this is going to be a good opportunity for me and are actually advocating for it. So I think that American business on this has been slow, but I think that part of that has to do with which parts of the economy and how their incentives are based are most directly engaged. So I would say when you think about this, you know, divvy up energy into the different sectors, the place where, you know, when I was talking to you about a 50% RPS standard in California, the utilities weren't opposing it, but they also weren't embracing it or pushing it. You know, I think when you look at the utility sector, yeah, they're different from American businesses. They're a mandated monopoly that's 100 years old. You know, what American business is 100 years old still depends on centralized decision-making and one-way lines. It's kind of, really. So one of the big questions here is, how is American ingenuity and American entrepreneurship gonna get expressed? How are we gonna have markets for this? How are we those gonna develop? Because when you think about what happened in telecommunications, where it's more of a consumer business, you think about what's happened in the last 30 years in telecommunications, where we basically had rotary phones, and now where are we? You know, I don't think kids would recognize a rotary phone.
You know,
there's a really different, you know, kind of speed of change in those two businesses, and utilities want to think in 30 to 40 years, and they have an incentive base which traditionally has been cost plus. That's not exactly, you know, I always tease and say to people who come up with great energy efficiency, you walk into a utility, it's like walking into Coca-Cola and saying, good news, I can cut your sales in half. It's like,
yeah.
Why is that good news?
Yeah, if you, I'll bring the audience back in a minute, just to follow up. How much potential do you think there is in this idea of disaggregated power, people producing more of their own power on their own roof or small cooperatives, if utility policy aligned with that goal?
So the question is distributed energy.
Yeah.
I don't think that the cheapest way for us, but first of all, the answer is God is going to be in what people come up with in ideas. But if you ask me, is the most efficient way to generate energy going to be on people's rooftops with them buying their own storage? That seems to me to be illogical.
Okay.
To me, the idea that we have, that we, you know, in this case, have shared interests, we can use things more efficiently together. You know, if you look at the cost of so-called utility-grade solar as opposed to rooftop solar, so, you know, the big solar arrays in the desert, they produce kilowatts cheaper than on your roof. Mm-hmm. Now, there are issues with them about siting. There, you know, a utility-grade solar is always going to need transmission. On your roof, if you had cheap enough storage, theoretically, you could be off the grid and be on your own. But the fact of the matter is, when you think this is just a commodity, it is very likely to me that utilities are going to be around and they're going to have to develop and be more interactive and more, you know, flexible. But there are absolutely advantages to working on this on a shared basis than everybody having to be their own utility.
Let's go over there. This question. Hold on the microphone.
I'm a San Franciscan, so I have a keen interest in this question. What about high-speed rail between San Francisco and Los Angeles? Controversial in our state, and what is its role in reducing emissions?
It is controversial. I think the controversy has to do with something that we can't know, which is ridership. You know, to the extent how many people want to take that train, so that when you think about it on any kind of cost benefit, whether it has to do with the money outlay versus the return or the how much energy we save, it's unclear. The one thing that does seem clear in California is we spend an awful lot of time on the freeways. The question is not high-speed rail, because you know I'm not sure that is really high speed when you really cut to the chase. The question is, what is the best way for us to move around the state in a way that is going to unclog our freeways and make our lives better? And I think when we do that, we are also going to have a more energy efficient world. Yeah. So I look at high speed rail and I say, it's a bet.
Don't kid yourself. Up here? Yeah. Good. We're almost done. You're almost at the finish line.
Tom, taking politics out of the equation for a second, you were almost conspicuous in not mentioning, I don't think, nuclear energy at any point. Why is that?
Well, I think people have a somewhat unidimensional attitude towards nuclear that I don't necessarily share. There are a bunch, meaning probably five efforts to come up with what I would think of as next generation nuclear. The issues with nuclear have always been about cost, siting cost, permitting cost. Right now, building a nuclear plant, I mean, it seems like it would be cheap, but if you really look at the cost per kilowatt hour, it ain't cheap. And that really has to do with siting and permitting. Secondly, waste. What are we going to do with the nuclear waste? And the third is, can we make sure that we don't, you know, that the material is safe and doesn't fall into the hands of people who would want to use it against us? There are next generation nuclear plants that are trying really hard to get there. Some of them seem really promising. They're pretty far out in terms of time. If you can come up with those answers, then that's a huge home run. The fact of the matter is, when I think about, you know, it's like the Holy Grail. People come up and always tell you, you know, I have Christ's shin bone in my locker. Well, a next generation nuke is one of those things where if you can come up with that, you know, then that is something that could be a gigantic advantage, huge plus, and would deal with the issues that people are worried about, which also I should say has to do with, you know, accidents. So, right. But there are people who are working really hard and have been working for at least a decade. I've been, you know, I talk to them reasonably frequently, and they try and keep me up, and they really are spending a lot of money. But to do a nuclear plant is like a $5 billion bet. So there aren't that many governments that are willing to make $5 billion bets.
We're almost out of time, but I think we have one more in the back. Go ahead, Katie.
Hi. I'm just curious to hear what you thought of the Pope's encyclical on climate change, and if you think it's possible to exploit, although I hate to use the Pope and exploit in one sentence, but you know, his position on this, because it was pretty unprecedented.
So obviously I love Francis. Right. And I did read the encyclical, and you know, obviously he's, you know, an incredible person doing an incredible job. I think that he is, if you read it, he's making a broader point in terms of asking us really to take a broader view of commerce and to see that it had, and to try and to be really boring about it, I believe what the Pope is asking for is very good cost accounting. He's asking us to include all the costs. You know, I think he talks a lot about the value of the dignity of work, the value of technology, the ability to make the world a better place, but he's asking us to take a broad vision of what we're trying to accomplish on the planet. And he's asking us to include, you know, I mean, the two traditional religious beliefs in this case are, one, preserve, you know, what God has given us, and two, take care of the most vulnerable on the planet. And he's making those points, you know, very deliberately, but he's talking about asking us in commerce to take a broad view of our impact and to say, you know, that we want to not only do well, but we want to take into account all the different impacts we have and try to take a holistic view of how we're going to proceed together on the planet.
Let me
love it.
In a final thought, not trying to make anyone uncomfortable, but we do have a remarkable situation where you have in the front row David Koch and you, who are often seen as the opposite poles of this debate. And I want to ask you what you would say, where you think...
If David were sitting in the front row.
Yes. is
impossible.
There, it could never happen. Is there any place that, if you were to speak to David Koch or other people who have been skeptical of your views, what would you say about how you can reach common ground? What would be the common ground that you think, not specifically the two of you, but the kind of the two poles that you represent can find common ground on this issue?
I'm not sure he is skeptical of my views, and I'm not sure I'm skeptical of his views.
Okay.
Because we've got, my point would be, I think what I'm saying is basically common sense and asking the market to solve a problem that we have. I don't view this as an ideological issue, actually. I feel like I would bet that Mr. Koch thinks the market is something that's very efficient in allocating capital and getting, you know, positive outcomes for the people who work and for the people they're trying to serve by producing products and services cheaply and efficiently. And that's what I want. From my point of view, and this is what I've been saying, it's not that I think that we have to agree on the policy, it's we have to agree on the problem. Because once we agree on the problem, then the fact that we, you know, that someone wants a bigger government and someone wants a smaller government and such, no, that's normal American politics. That we've been doing that for 250 years together. That doesn't remotely bother me. From my point of view, I'm surprised it hasn't happened, but I believe it will. I believe we will end up pulling on the same oar to solve this, and it will be good for American businesses, it will be good for American workers, and we'll do something that we're proud of. And I feel that that is something where American business is gonna do this, and it's gonna lead the world, and we're gonna be very proud. And if we think we're doing this without the people who are sophisticated in energy, that's dumb. We're gonna do this with the people who are sophisticated in energy.
Well, it's hard to imagine a better note on which to end. Thank you, Tom Steyer. Thank you.